But next, I'd like to reintroduce Dr. Liu to come talk about consequences of unilateral hearing loss in children. Thanks.
All right. So now I'm going to go and give you kind of a much higher level view. This is, we don't have as many specifics as I wish we had, but we do have some overall data that will hopefully get your appetite whetted for some more details, and hopefully interest more people in being involved in this whole area of research. So I want to begin with this quote from an early group of researchers who looked at children with unilateral hearing loss. They said that historically, the involvement of hearing health professionals in the management of children with unilateral hearing loss has been limited. The conventional approach was to identify the cause of the hearing loss and to assure the parents that there would be no handicap. And I think that's true for many of us older folks in the audience. It was certainly true for a good portion of my training. And hopefully, though, with the introduction that I'm giving you here, I don't think we can feel as confident. And hopefully I can convince you of that. So I'm going to talk a little bit about these consequences. They include the speech-language outcomes, educational, behavior, quality of life, and then some studies that we have been doing looking at the brain and maybe having some possible explanations for why these consequences are occurring. So in infants and toddlers, there's not a whole lot of information. There has been some suggestion that there may be delay, not necessarily in when the kids start talking, but maybe in the first two-word phrase. And so that was first documented by a German researcher. And they found that the kids that they looked at had their first two-word phrase at almost 2 years of age. In the study that we did in St. Louis, we found that if we compared the kids with unilateral hearing loss against their normal hearing siblings, there seemed to be about a three-month delay between 18 and a half months and 15 and a half months. But that's by parent recall, and so, of course, that's subject to parents remembering when their kids started saying the first two-word phrase. This last study that I just posted up here is one that is very recent and is very exciting to me. It's coming out of Israel, in which they actually looked at auditory behavior and pre-verbal vocalizations, and they compared a group of 34 children, infants, about 9 months old, against a larger group of children with normal hearing, again, about 9 months old. And they found that the vast majority of children with unilateral hearing loss had normal auditory behavior and normal preverbal vocalizations in the normal range, but that 21% were delayed, two standard deviations below the mean, versus 4% among those for normal hearing. Similarly, for preverbal vocalizations, 41% were delayed in this group of unilateral hearing loss infants versus 3.6%. So we're talking about a 4 to 8-fold increased rate of delay. Now, this is still parent questionnaire, but the researchers did prep them. They gave them this questionnaire like about a week ahead of time so they can think about what their infants were doing. Plus, the other strength is that they actually divided these children into high risk and low risk in terms of for other developmental delays. And so this is still a small group of infants, but I think it's still very important information. In the preschool children, again, we just have very few studies. The first one from Sweden showed that 4 to 6-year-old kids had a delay in the Swedish standardized language test compared to their normal hearing peers. And then in Rhode Island, they showed that if grouping kids with mild bilateral hearing loss and unilateral hearing loss, that the communication, motor skills, and adaptive behavior scores were lower compared to a large group of children with normal hearing. Again, still, these studies are very small. And so it's hard to say that you can, you know, say completely for sure that there's not a lot of selection bias. That is, you know, these are a select group of kids of parents who are more concerned than the typical parent about their child's unilateral hearing loss, and maybe that's the reason why they're enriched in these problems that they're finding. but it's still, they're fairly consistent. And in the study that we published about 5 years ago now, we matched children with unilateral hearing loss versus sibling controls. And we did that for several reasons. One is because we were very concerned that parent and family characteristics had a big influence. Poverty, we know, has a problem. Parenting styles can have play a big factor. Parent education can have a big factor. So we wanted to correct for that, as well as correct for some of the genetic issues that, you know, are just impossible to control for. So what we found was that there was a much higher odds of speech-language therapy. 42% of all children with unilateral hearing loss had had speech therapy at some point or another. That's 2.5 times their siblings. And they all had lower scores on oral language skills. So these scores are based on a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. So if you're familiar with the IQ scores, it's the same type of a scale. The average is 100, standard deviation is 15. So that for these kids, language comprehension was 91 on average for the kids with unilateral hearing loss, 98 for the normal hearing siblings. The oral expression, 94 if they had unilateral hearing loss, 101 if it was a sibling. And the composite scores, there was a 9-point gap, 90 for the child with unilateral hearing loss versus 99 if they had normal hearing. And these were all statistically significant. Now we realize, again, as I mentioned, that there's a lot of factors that go into language development. So we took a look at this using a technique called multivariable regression, and we looked at that oral composite score and looked at other factors that we think had a very good chance of affecting their language score. So we included their native IQ, their age, whether they're male or female, and whether they fell at or below the poverty level. And you can see that all of these factors up here are statistically significant, and yet unilateral hearing loss still had a persistent almost 6-point difference. That is a negative difference on their oral composite score. So it's not perfect, but it gives you a sense that there is a role here for that unilateral hearing loss to be affecting their language. And when we looked at cognition scores, this just shows the right, left, and controls, just because there's a lot of people who had concerns that maybe there was a right ear effect. And so what we found, really there is none, but there still is a small difference compared to controls, but it's small. The effect size is 0.2 to 0.3 standard deviations. It is small. And again, if we subject this to a multivariable regression, looking at all some other things that could play a part, especially maternal education here, you can see that maternal education has a stronger effect on their cognition scores, but still that the hearing loss did have a small component. So we also wanted to find out what happened to these kids over time. So out of this 74, actually a larger group than that, we followed some of them over a period of 3 years. And again, we looked at cognition, language, a standardized achievement score, the behavior as tested on by the CBCL, which is a standardized behavior assessment, of course, hearing, and the school records. And again, we looked, did some multi-level regression in order to try to figure out what was going on over time. And so this table shows all of the outcomes that we looked at. So full IQ, verbal IQ, performance IQ, these are the language scales, and this is the achievement scores. Okay, and again, these are all based on a mean of 100 for normal kids with a standard deviation of 15. So let me go through this table a little bit more, because this is a little complex. So initial status is meaning if we're looking at modeling a kid at age 6 compared to at age 12, this would be their average score at age 6. Okay, so for the IQ scores, they're pretty close to the mean of 100, but you see that they really drop off in the language scores, 91, 85, 85. But the achievement scores are not so bad. They're pretty close to the norm. The rate of change refers to what happens over time, just naturally as they grow older. And theoretically, the rate of change should be zero, because these are standardized scores. They're standardized for age, so that as the child grows older, the mean should theoretically stay the same. It should be zero. And what we're seeing is that there are significant changes over time for the IQ scores, especially for the language scores, but there's no change in the achievement scores. And the pseudo R squared is a measure of how much, what percentage of this change, what proportion of this change is due to time only. And anything over about 0.1, so 10%, is considered to be important. So I just wanted to have you pay attention to this oral expression score, because this is one of the most affected. So these kids with unilateral hearing loss, their average decrease at age 6 was, you know, their average score was 85. That's a full standard deviation below the mean. However, they did improve over time, almost 3 points per year. And that accounted for almost 19% of change over time. So there is definitely improvement. And we'll get back to, and then I'll go on to the adolescents and have a little bit more information there. So if we move on to what happens with education and behavior, we'll see that these educational and behavioral problems have been documented for a long time. And this started with Fred Bess and Anne-Marie Tharp. Euler and Matkin and others in other groups documented this. And so what I just summarized here is that 22 to 59% of kids received additional help. That was documented back in the 80s and 90s. And the 24 to 35% grade failures compared to 3% nationally, I think, is what captured a lot of people's attention, again, back in the 80s and 90s. And yet, nothing happened. There was no change in how these kids were perceived. What we found is that compared to normal hearing, there was a 4.5 increased rate of individualized education plans or programs. So those of you familiar with IEPs know that this is something that the school does in order to help kids who are having difficulties either behaviorally or academically, or with speech or some other things that is thought to affect their education. So this is the school saying, this child has a problem, we are putting into place a program to help them achieve where they need to be. And so rather than failing the kids and holding them back a year in school, they're giving them IEPs. And so what we found is that, there's a much higher rate, and then these in siblings. You wouldn't expect quite that much of a difference in a sibling control group. Behaviorally, what we found longitudinally is that a lot of the kids are still having problems in several competency scales. So, 20%, one-fifth of the kids scored less than third percentile for competency in activities, social, school, and total competencies. Okay, so they were not doing well. Teachers rated that a quarter of them had an academic area of weakness or executive function. And about half of them continued to have IEPs throughout the entire 3 years. So this was not going away. So again, this is a little bit complex, but I wanted you to show the change over time. So we did a follow-up study looking at some of these kids and adolescents, so 13 to 17-year-olds. And we again looked at their language scores. And so I'm comparing side by side our earlier study of the 6 to 12-year-olds versus those who are 13 to 17-year-old, the adolescents. So again, you can see that this is receptive, expressive, composite. So just try to focus maybe on the green here and show that compared in the unilateral hearing loss versus normal hearing, you can see that little difference that I already went over earlier. What happens in the adolescents, though, again, if you focus in on the green, is that unilateral hearing loss, they did get better, right, compared to the mean. Instead of being around 91, they're about 98 or so. The problem is their siblings also got better. And if anything, the difference between them got bigger. So now we're not talking about a half a standard deviation difference. We're talking about a full standard deviation difference. And that's concerning, because are they going to catch up or are they not? And this is also seen in the cognitive scores. Again, the children with unilateral hearing loss, normal hearing, and the younger group, there was a very small difference here. But again, the kids with unilateral hearing loss, they seemed to hold about, in the study maybe they got a little worse, but then again, the kids with normal hearing, the siblings continue to increase their scores. And the hard part is that IQ scores, it's not a hard and fast thing. We know that over time that there seems to be, have gradually been an increase in the IQ score in the population, but no one really has done, in, you know, longitudinally. If you tested these kids at, you know, 3 or 5 or 10 years later, do the IQ scores stay stable, or do they get, do they improve over time, or do they worsen over time? We don't know. But this seems to show that the gap between the kids with unilateral hearing loss and their siblings is growing bigger. And that's a concern. Okay, quality of life. So the WHO, the World Health Organization, defines quality of life as the individual's perception of their position in life in the context of the culture and value systems in which they live and in relation to their goals, expectations, standards, and concerns. So this is an area, as we were talking to the patients, talking to the parents, we realized that there's a lot that we weren't capturing just by looking at language, cognition, that what Dr. Leibold was mentioning in terms of listening effort, I heard that over and over and over again, that parents were saying they come home from school and they're exhausted compared. They may be doing the same level of schoolwork, they're getting the same grades, but they come home and they're exhausted. They can't do anything else. So one of the problems that we had at the time is we had no quality of life instrument for specifically for kids with hearing loss. We did use a generic quality of life instrument, but it didn't seem to be very sensitive to the kinds of issues that we were interested in for these kids. So we developed what was called the Hearing Environments and Reflection on Quality of Life Survey in children. We have two forms now that have been validated in children and adolescents. And this is self-report. So these are the kids themselves who are answering the questions about how they feel about how they are doing. And so the studies that we've done to validate them have looked at kids with normal hearing, unilateral hearing loss, and bilateral hearing loss. So this is the data that we collected in children with unilateral hearing loss. And so these are the various domains: families, friends, activities, school, feelings, and the total score. And I think the scale is 100, maximum score is 100. And we don't have the bottom here, but it is conceivable that you could get a zero, but not really. So what you can see is that the kids with normal hearing, even they will occasionally have some difficulties with hearing. And so their mean is really right at 95. But you can see that there's a big drop-off in the kids with unilateral hearing loss and bilateral hearing loss. And actually, they're much more similar to each other than unilateral or to bilateral. We thought that they might be somewhere in the middle, and that does not seem to be the case. And similarly, if we looked at children and the adolescents, and again, this is done a little bit differently, instead of looking at the different domains, I'm looking at the total score, and we're comparing whether they had normal hearing, unilateral, mild, bilateral, moderate, severe, and profound bilateral hearing loss. And so these bars are the means, and the horizontal lines are the means. The boxes are the 95% interquartile range, the 25 to 75% interquartile range. And then these long whiskers are the 95% intervals, and then these are the outliers. So again, if you kind of focus in on the blue bars, the normal hearing kids, their mean is 95, and they have a pretty tight cluster. There are a couple outliers out there. But what was interesting is that if you looked at the unilateral kids, they're more similar to the moderate bilateral, and you know they're not that far off from the severe and profound, which is surprising. Interestingly, the mild bilateral, they don't seem to have as much difficulty, and I don't know whether that's because their hearing loss is more symmetric, and so they're actually able to make more use of those binaural cues that Dr. Leibold was talking about, whereas if you have this asymmetry, it causes some confusion. I don't know. This is speculation, but it makes me wonder about what's going on there. So why are they experiencing these problems? So we delved into some MRI studies because we do have a very strong center at Washington University looking at children and different clinical populations as well, normal kids, and trying to figure out what's going on with their heads. The modality that they use there is a resting state functional connectivity. So what that does is it takes children in a passive state, put them in an MRI scanner, and just measures their oxygen levels in their brains over time. And the thought is that the areas that fluctuate together, the blood level, oxygen levels fluctuate together, are thought to reflect networks. And so the advantage is that it's passive. You don't have to have their participation. They just need to stay awake. And they have found that there are multiple networks involved in different areas of the brain. There are other centers that have looked at functional MRI, where you actually are looking for activation or deactivation of specific areas in the brain when you are giving kids tasks. And I'll talk about some of those studies that were done in Cincinnati and Pittsburgh, which are pretty exciting. And then we did other studies where we looked at diffusion tensor imaging, which is looking at the white matter tracts of the brain. So we have the cortex, the gray matter, which has all of the cells and the neurons that talk to each other. And the white matter tracts are those long axons, the tracts that deliver the information across different areas of the brain. So what are we finding? So we find that there's differences in brain processing in children with unilateral hearing loss. That pertains to the auditory association areas. There were changes in networks associated with tasks, language processing, and working memory. So those are executive functions. There were changes in the visual association areas. There was reduced deactivation of what's called the default mode network. That is, when you're resting, there is a certain level of activity that happens in a network. But when your brain is awake, that all that activity should go down. There was reduction. They didn't reduce as much in children with unilateral hearing loss. And there seemed to be further changes in the white matter tracts in kids with unilateral hearing loss, including those that we think are associated with hearing. And what's interesting is that there seems to be potentially some relationships between the integrity of these white matter tracts and educational outcomes. So to summarize, we still need a lot more information. This, I would say that these studies, even though we have, they seem to be in generally in the same direction, they're relatively small groups of kids. So again, I am always still concerned, is there a selection bias here? So unilateral hearing loss appears to be associated with delays in acquisition of preverbal behavior, speech and language in infants and preschool children. Some school-age children may have speech and or language delays, but it's definitely not all. That improvement in language appears to happen over time, but there doesn't seem to be any catch-up compared to siblings. And I didn't talk about this as much, but there does seem to be risk factors for delays. That is, poverty, the socioeconomic status can have a profound impact on language and speech. Maternal education, male sex, a low cognitive ability to begin with, and then hearing severity may be an issue as well. Educationally, in the past, there was found to be a much increased rate of grade failures. It's probably not true anymore. The national average is around 9 to 10% of grade failures. There doesn't seem to be much difference now among normal hearing kids versus kids with unilateral hearing loss. But there's definitely an increase in those who are getting IEPs and holding on to IEPs. More behavioral issues, and a lot of it is hear from parents. My teacher wants him to evaluate for ADD. My teacher wants him to be placed on medication for ADD because he's not paying attention in class. Teachers are saying that the kids aren't as strong enough academically, and they're not keeping up. And again, the risk factors for these problems may be very similar. So, summary, there's a high rate of speech therapy that's approaching 50%. There are language delays in infancy through adolescence, and the difference may be widening rather than disappearing. The verbal IQ differences do not disappear and also may widen with increasing age. There are MRI studies of the brain that show there are differences in processing, networks, and white matter tracts. So the big question is, do the children with unilateral hearing loss have a permanent decrease in their language and cognition? That is this a true disability? Or do they have a slower acquisition over time? That is, if you give them an extra year or two or more, they'll actually catch up, and this is just a delay. I don't have the answer to that question. We need a lot more work before we get to that point. Okay, thank you.
I'm wondering about the risk factors for delay. Why is maternal education more of a factor than paternal education? I'm just wondering why that is a difference, if you could expand on that.
So in a lot of studies of children with development, because moms have traditionally spent more time with kids in the preschool and infant ages, it's thought that maternal education has a stronger impact than paternal education. That might be changing with changing demographics, but we haven't seen that as yet. There are a lot of studies suggesting why that education might have play a role. It may be that mothers with higher education levels are reading to their kids more, they're talking to their kids more, they're enriching their environment more, are making sure they get into teaching environments where there's less interference. You know, there's not as big a daycare. They're getting more one-on-one. It's hard to say. We haven't teased that apart, but that's not just in hearing loss. That's certainly, it's been shown in many, many studies of children across many different disease entities.
Thank you for sharing all of this information. As you're conducting these studies, are you considering things like the classroom acoustics and the use of assistive technology in the educational environment as you're analyzing the outcomes for these kids?
So I haven't, because it was a lot of this. I didn't expect to see some of this stuff when we started these studies, honestly. And part of the reason why we use the sibling pairs was so that we could not worry about the acoustic environment, because they would conceivably be going to the same school districts and hopefully not as too many different environments. Some of the kids in our study actually attended schools where they have sound-filled FM systems, and so a couple of school districts up through kindergarten through third grade, they have speakers in four corners of the room, and so presumably all the children can benefit from that rather than just the kids with, you know, hearing loss. That becomes more difficult, of course, as the children age out of those classrooms and then they enter more challenging listening environments. You too.
I noticed, and maybe you answered this at the previous talk, but for the quality of life figure you put up, you had broken down the bilateral into severities, but the unilateral you had just one group. Was there a separate, did you look at, I'm sure you did, look at the breakdown in severity for the unilateral? Or?
So we didn't for the sake of that particular paper, but I would say that there isn't a huge difference. There's a huge variability from child to child. Some children with profound unilateral hearing loss deny that they have any difficulty at all, and others are very much impacted. And similarly, there are some children with mild unilateral hearing loss who are very severely impacted, and others who, you know, don't think it matters at all. So it really does vary from child to child. Of course, the ones that have, I'm starting to use this more frequently in my clinic. You'd think I'd use it all the time, but sometimes it's hard to get them to sit there and just to finish the questionnaire. So when they do, and if they're showing that there is a lot of impact, I will spend more time talking to the child and the parent. As you know, these you may really want to think about trying a hearing aid, especially if they're mild and the unilateral, and see whether this helps some of these difficulties go away.
So I appreciate all of your data. It looked like the kids who were in the longitudinal study had lower scores than your overall sample in the younger kids. Do you think there's a self-selection in some, if you had looked at the whole population? Because your means were 90 for language in the younger sample, but 85 for the older sample?
Selection could be part of it, certainly, but I think overall, the other part of it is that the kids in the longitudinal study started, usually were younger when they started, and so I was kind of relatively enriched in the 6 and 7-year-olds as we followed them over time, and I had very few that were 9 and 10 when we started. And so I think that plays a part as well, because again, what you saw is that as they got older, their scores naturally seemed to improve. And so it's possible that as and that was also true with the overall study, is that as the kids got older, it seems like their language scores did improve too. So I think, I don't know if that answered your question. There's another question back there? No?
Mm-hmm. I work in the schools, and I just had a couple observations. Is I'm seeing that what you're showing in the studies is what we're seeing in the schools, the behavior, the language. I'm noticing more and more children I identify in the schools with hearing, unilateral hearing loss. The parents will say, oh yeah, had speech therapy as a preschooler. One question I had, and I think one impact I see in the schools is children of parents who are not native English speakers. Mm-hmm. Was that a factor in your study at all? Or were they all native?
So they were all native family? English speakers.
Okay.
Yeah, we felt like it would cause too much difficulty if we mm-hmm. had, you know, immigrant families. Mm-hmm. So, but I will say that one other impact of education and a higher socioeconomic status is that I think those families, mothers, often feel more empowered to get involved with the schools and get in, you know, the teachers and administrators spaces and get more services for their kids. So that may have something to do with it as well. Down here. Oh, up there and down here.
Thank you for this. Just a logistical question. Your quality of life survey that you've developed, is it available?
Yes, it is available. We've been gratified. There's been a lot of interest, but we have been licensing it through the Office of Technology Management. We just don't want people to not acknowledge where they are getting it from. And so, yes, it's definitely available. You're welcome to email me, or I have a lab website, which is not so easy to find, unfortunately. I'd be happy to share it with you. There was someone else up there. Yeah.
My question is, looking at the standard scores of 91, 94, 90, those are still considered well within the average range for
yes.
language. So
right.
You know, the students I see are 70s, 60s, 50s. So I look at that, and it doesn't terrify me.
Yeah. So I think that's always been the difficulty, like for instance with the earlier studies in the 80s and 90s, is that the kids were falling in the normal range for the most part, but they were often in the low normal range. And the question is, we're comparing siblings. You know, would you be satisfied as a parent if one child was dropping off and struggling a whole lot more than another child, and you think it's because of their hearing? And that's the challenge that we face in the schools, is because the schools are looking for kids who are just not doing well at all, right? And so these kids are not necessarily not doing well. They're maybe in the low normal range. They may be, they're getting lots of help at home, but they're struggling. So the question is, could we be helping them not to struggle so much? Does it need to be this hard? Okay, and the problem is we also don't know what the long-term sequela of this is going to be. I've heard so many adults with unilateral hearing loss that they avoid, and teenagers as well, they avoid situations where they're in a large groups of people. They avoid jobs where they know they have to interface with a lot of people. So that may limit their opportunities in certain professions or their leadership capacities. And that's not true over across the board, but I wonder. And so I think that the studies still need to be done. Does this affect their ability to get into college? Does it affect their ability to get the job of their choice? Does it affect their job of choice and what they ultimately want to do? You know, so much of our our world now is technology and communication driven. And I've been following articles where in the US, we're not going to get more industrial jobs. They're more high tech. They require cognitive skills, interpersonal skills. Are we hampering our kids just because they have a unilateral hearing loss if we don't help them with those things and develop those skills?
Yep. From your outcome studies, can you tease out the outcome with kids who wear a hearing aid in one ear versus kids who don't wear anything?
So not in my studies, just because there are a lot of kids who weren't wearing anything. They may have had access to a couple FM systems, but that didn't seem to make a difference, at least in the small studies that we have. But we did do one study where we looked at kids with mild, moderate unilateral hearing loss, and we fitted them with hearing aids, conventional hearing aids, digital ones, and found that they did better. If we looked at, for instance, BKB-SYN, speech and noise test, they did improve. And they rated their quality of life as being much better. But that's not all kids. It was 6 out of 8. I mean, it was a very small study. There was only 8 kids. 6 out of 8 loved them. 2 of them hated them. And so I think it really does depend on the child, probably their configuration of their hearing loss, what their needs and wants were. And of course, and these were younger kids, so the question is, teenagers, we know that they don't like hearing aids to begin with. Will they wear them if you offer them? So that's, I think we have opportunities to help them, but whether they take them or not is, left to be seen. There's another question up there.
Some of the old central auditory processing studies talked about a dominant ear versus a non-dominant ear for speech signals. Are we looking at the effect of the unilateral hearing loss on the dominant versus the non-dominant ear at all?
So I can't say that it's hard for me to say I know how to figure out the dominant versus non-dominant, but we've looked at right ear and left ear differences, and we haven't found any difference between the two.
Do you know if any of the MRI studies looked at sort of acutely taking away hearing versus the kids with chronic unilateral hearing loss, and what did they control for that in their processing?
So there are actually quite a few studies in adults who have had sudden onset unilateral hearing loss, usually from removal of acoustic neuromas or brain tumors or other things like that. And there is gradual change in the brain and the way it's connected over a period of 1 to 2 years. So the studies that I have mentioned, though, are in kids who were probably born with unilateral hearing loss. Again, the difficulty is that not until about 2000, 2002 do we have a large population of kids who were diagnosed at birth, and many of them weren't identified until they're 4, 5, 6 years old. So likely they had congenital hearing loss, all the ones that I've talked about, but we can't verify that completely. So since they were young. Thank you.